I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Getting a firm, well-deserved vacation, Mary Ann Burton is here.
Sandy Flora.
Here.
Mike Isley.
Here.
Spencer Kingers.
Present.
Cody Nelson.
Present.
Dave Wetherington.
The first order of business are the minutes from the February 3rd, 2023 meeting. Are there any additions, corrections?
Motion to pass the last minute.
Is there a second?
Second.
Without objections, the next meeting is for. Department reports were submitted with your packet, except for the chief's report, which I'll send out separately to the council and to any others who might be interested. Without objection, those reports will be added to the record in minutes for this meeting. And Sandy, do you want to start on the area plan commission meeting?
We had a favorable recommendation for our new comprehensive language plan. Buildings are down, new builds are down, and fees are down. Elected officers.
Spencer, do you want to report on the Delphi redevelopment commission?
Yeah, we had a brief discussion about the budget. We're going to discuss that at the next REC meeting, and also elected our officers. It's a pretty short meeting.
Oh, yeah, do you not yet put the office on the meeting?
So we have a meeting for the day to do all officer elections and budgets and everything.
Percy had their first board meeting of the year, and again, it was mostly to elect officers, approve plans, or discuss the budget for your priorities. And the transportation commission has not met yet this year. So that pretty much wraps up the report, and will be included in the record of minutes. Rachel Robinson from Adam Wakelin, welcome. HWC Engineering is here tonight for two purposes, but the first is to fill the council in on the park or the bicycle pedestrian master plan that they have been working with the city on. And this was funded in large part from a grant from the Department of Health. Will dovetail, I think, nicely with the conversation that has just been So, with that, I'll try to bring up the PowerPoint. Let me see if I can share this.
The public one, not wrong?
Yeah.
Okay. I can see.
So, that those on Facebook can see it as well.
Part of the bike and ped plan planning portion of this.
give you a brief overview of the project. Just for those of you who may not know what a bike ped plan is, it is a master plan to help local leaders and staff when making decisions about future growth, connectivity, and safety. Why is Delphi preparing one? As we talked about, the city got a grant from the State Department of Health. This is to assist community-wide planning efforts supporting bike and pedestrian activities so that there's higher rates of active living and physical activity within your community. So less cars and more feet. Public engagement. So what we did was we kicked off a public engagement process where we did an online survey, and we also had a public workshop. The public workshop was probably one of the most fun parts of this planning process. We had 16 people attend. You can see in the photo on the screen. We had maps that we spread out on these tables. We had our participants mark it up, tell us where there were gaps in your existing network. We talked about what types of facilities are needed, and just in areas for maybe future trailheads and things like that. We also did an online survey, and we had 75 responses with that survey. We asked a variety of questions, you know, what types of facilities are you comfortable using? How often do you walk or bike? What things are missing in the city of Delphi? We came up then with our plan, vision, and our goals. And our vision is that the city of Delphi will continue to develop a comprehensive and visible bicycle and pedestrian network that remains an asset to the community. The city will ensure that the network supports diversity and is inclusive of all ages, abilities, and incomes. It promotes health, safety, education, and recreation, and it connects local and regional destinations. So not just looking at what we can get to within the city of Delphi, but outside of the city of Delphi as well. And you guys all, you know, have one of the best park and recreation facilities, but historic trail system in any community that I think worked in the state of Indiana. So you guys do have a lot to be proud of, and we didn't want to take anything away from that. It was just, how do we add to it to make it even more of an asset than it already is? We had four goals that we developed throughout the process. You know, we wanted to improve and expand Delphi's existing bike and pedestrian facilities, connect those local and regional destinations. We wanted to identify existing deficiencies in the bike ped network and then develop a priority list of projects. We wanted to continue highlighting Delphi's rich cultural heritage through the Delphi Historic Trail System. And we also wanted to look at how we could implement education and encouragement initiatives so that we could inform Delphi residents, your workforce, youth, and the youth of the public health, social, and economic benefits of biking and bicycling. A big piece of this is looking at your schools and working with your school system too. You guys did a safe routes to school plan many, many years ago that had some projects that came out of that. There was a lot of programming pieces that I think during COVID kind of went away because, you know, we had to stay home, but there's a great opportunity for those types of programs to come back. We also wanted to ensure safety and security initiatives are in place so that all network users can walk, bike, and hike confidently. We wanted to provide policy and programming support for the expansion of walking and bicycling opportunities in the city of Delphi. And we also wanted to look at how we pursue different funding opportunities to help support the development of more trails, more sidewalks, and more crosswalks. There are five E's that typically guide really good bike and pedestrian plans. This list was developed by the League of American Bicyclists, and they look at these five components. So equity and accessibility, education, encouragement, evaluation and planning, and also engineering. So it's not just about building facilities, it's also about all the stuff that supports those facilities. So if you don't feel like you have enough information about how to get from point A to point B, what is the point of having the sidewalk or the trail if you don't even know it exists? So it looks at, you know, what can we do on your websites? What kind of policies and programming do we need to have in place? Some training, you know, do we need to do bicycle rodeos so that people feel more comfortable riding their bike and know what the rules are for riding their bike? So people who are in vehicles understand, you know, that cars can be part of road transportation network. So overall, we developed this network map, and there was a lot of help that went into this from your local residents that participated in those meetings. We also had a survey that looked at these maps and networks and, you know, different facilities that were getting proposed to tell us, okay, this is what we really need, this, we're on the right track, or maybe this one isn't so viable, let's wait until later and add that in later. So this is kind of that overall network. The green stars show you generally your destinations, which are your park and recreation assets. We also have schools listed, other places are like your library, you know, destinations that people want to go. And then we try to connect the dots and look at appropriate facilities that can help get you from point A to point B. With that map that was shown, the steering committee did come up with priority projects that have been listed in the plan. Those priority projects, we're calling those the engineering piece of it, and those engineering projects do have a cost, a ballpark range of what that, those projects will cost the city in the long run. So those are all included in that plan. The next steps for the bike ped plan, like I said at the beginning, is that it will get adopted into the comprehensive plan. This is a requirement of the grant itself, is that it gets adopted into that comprehensive plan, which you guys will be looking at adopting tonight. The comprehensive plan, bike ped plan, will go to area plan commission next, and then it will come back to city council for you guys to consider it for adoption. Are there any questions about the bike ped plan? Thank you all. Oh, you have a question?
Yeah, I was just wondering, so this will be funded by grant money, or where does this come from?
It's going to be a variety of sources. And what we do is we identify priority projects. So the engineering projects have been kind of picked out, but we try to write the plan in a way that if there are unforeseen opportunities that come up, like let's say there is a new funding source that really makes it viable to do a piece of the project that wasn't listed as a priority, city can bump it up to be a priority project then. Some of the things that are like the programming pieces and you know, policy things, some of it can be done in-house that city council can do as staff. Some of them are going to be grant funded. Some of those larger infrastructure pieces typically are easier to fund if you have a grant component to it. Yes.
One more question. So has there been a demographic study or anything to decide how many people would actually use the trails?
There is.
Because I'm looking at, there was like 75 people responded, which is less than 0.2% that even looked at this. I'm just curious, you know, is there going to be people use it? Or, I mean, what kind of studies have been done to see that?
I think it's a city priority to build that culture of walking and biking within the city. And, you know, there are ways of counting, you know, there are like bicycle trail counters that can be done and put out there to see how many people are using it, and some communities can track, you know, if the usage goes up, if you provide more facilities, and that wasn't necessarily what we did here. But it does look at a comprehensive plan that looks at many different areas of that network, and it's not just all about construction projects, it's about education component too. So I think looking at all those things and trying to put them hand in hand with each other, it's really about growing and cultivating, you know, that network or that culture within Delphi, which I think you guys already have a big bicycle and pedestrian culture here anyway. It seems like they're, you know, just with the Delphi Historic Trail System, as far out as much as that has been developed over the years, I think there is a need and a want for those types of things. But it is hard to put a number to it. So
they studied the trails that we already have, and they checked to see how many people are going up and using them?
We did not as part of this project.
I'm not against it. I just kind of curious if you can spend money. You know, is people going to use it, or are you just building something and trying to talk people into using it?
It's something that we already have. We have over 14 miles of this the existing trail systems. Mm-hmm. Part of the goal here was, we know that in many cases those trails don't connect, or where they connect, it's not necessarily a safe crossing. So part of what this study was attempting to do was to look at the existing trails, see where connections are needed, where we can improve the safety elements on those trails, and also then look at other opportunities for new trails. We know that from the statistics that the Canal Association keeps, that the The trail system is very heavily used. That's the trail system that is most known as the Delphi trail. But certainly the amount of walking on trails in the downtown area and in other parts of the city is anecdotally known to be very high. We want, our goal here is to identify those trail systems where we can make them safer and improve accessibility and encourage people to use them. It's part of the Department of Health fund studies of this sort in order to encourage communities to become more active and to encourage our children to in the communities to be more engaged in safe biking and hiking areas. So.
So this is more connecting the trails, not necessarily putting like you see in other cities and towns where you have a bike trail on the road. So it's not necessarily that, it's just connecting the trails.
It's a combination. So there is some of that that's been identified in the plan. Those are called sheroes. Some of them are sheroes, sometimes there's bike lanes, and those different types of facilities have been looked at in the plan, and then those are outlined in there. So if there's an area that, I don't think we had any bike lanes designated in Delphi, but we did have one project that was a shero, which is a shared lane facility that would have some pavement markings on it saying, like, there might be bicyclists on this road that's been designated as a part of the trail system. Yeah.
You mentioned something about a steering committee. How many people were on the steering committee? How many times did they meet? And how did they get on the steering committee?
We had four, I guess it was technically called an advisory committee. That is the language that the Department of Health wanted us to use, so mm-hmm. It was an advisory committee. I don't remember off the top of my head how many members we had on it, but it was, I believe it was 10 or 12. Yep. And we had four meetings throughout the process, and I believe the city gave us the recommendations for who would be participating on the steering committee.
So that would have been a city committee meeting?
I'm not sure how that was.
Okay.
It was a steering committee that was selected to work on the master plan.
Anyone else with any questions?
Thank you, Rachel. As Rachel was indicating, this plan will now move to the Area Planning Commission on February 26th, where we will make a recommendation. The next piece of this would be to adopt this as part of our comprehensive land use plan. And so we will make a requirement that fits the criteria for the comprehensive plan and then make a recommendation, either favorable, unfavorable, or no recommendation. That will come back to the city council at our March meeting. And if the council so chooses, it would then be our first amendment to what we hope will be the adoption of the comprehensive plan. Any other questions for Rachel on the five-day plan?
I have one more. You talked about safety. What kind of safety measures are worked into this trail? I mean, are we having cameras or what?
There are recommendations in the plan. I do know our committee did talk a lot about the safety components on the trails, and so there are recommendations for cameras in areas that may need them, lighting along the trails.
Oh, yeah.
Intersection that might be busy, how can we
said, we keep talking about bicycles and walking trails. We don't have any bicycle trails, correct?
The walking trails are also bicycle trails.
You said cross with a bicycle safely.
And that was one of the things that we were looking at in the study, so that we could make sure that we could include crossings where were necessary to make them safer.
Can we go back to the map?
Yeah.
See how many of those dangerous crossing points there are?
I don't think we have, I mean, we can go back to the map and look at that.
But one of the things we talked about during the plan development is that there's a lot of trails right now within Delphi that are a stone surface. And so we did talk a lot on the steering committee about, we need to articulate what the surfaces are of those trails so that people who are coming to Delphi that don't live here, that don't, you know, don't know what the surface is. You know, some people who are the on-road cyclists have skinny tires, so maybe driving on stone pathways is not ideal for that type of user, but, you know, more of the mountain biker, off-roading trail or riders, they would love to ride on stone trails. So, you know, there's a difference in user, and that's something that we were trying to be mindful of as we were working through the plan. Anything else?
Yes, you guys.
Not too much longer on the agenda.
So, fittingly, the first item of new business is Resolution 2023-2 to adopt the Comprehensive Land Use Plan, which received a favorable recommendation from the Area Planning Commission at its January 24th meeting. Is there a motion to adopt Resolution 2023-2?
I'll make that motion.
Is there a second? As part of the discussion, Rachel had another just brief overview of this process and of the plan itself that I can share the screen.
This project was one that the city did get a grant through the Office of Community and Rural Affairs to complete this project. They hired my firm, HWC Engineering, to help them through the process. So these were the four key phases. We did a ton of public input with it. You may remember doing a survey for that. We did have a lot more responses on the original comprehensive plan survey than we did the bike head survey. We did a couple of public input meetings. We had, you know, this room all set up with different boards, and we had quite a few members of the public participate in that. Can we click forward? I think we have pictures of that. The community workshop had over 25 participants attending. We had 7 stakeholder meetings with, we had 17 people that were interviewed during those stakeholder meetings. We did an online survey, and we had 183 responses from that. And we also had a project website, and at the time that I put this presentation together, we had 685 views on the website. And the website was kind of the keeper of all the information of the plan, so every time we had a meeting, we posted the presentation on there. When we did public input, we posted the public input meetings on there, so it was kind of your one-stop shop for all things comprehensive plan. Just to give you a high-level overview of what's in the plan, we had 5 key strategies that we included. The first one was to increase quality housing opportunities. Second one was to expand local government capacity. Third is to support local jobs and the workforce. The fourth one is to invest in quality of place. And the fifth one was to strengthen an already vibrant downtown. So all of the goals and objectives that were included in the plan all relate back to those 5 key strategies. We also put together a future land use map. That is kind of the main to include in a comprehensive plan. A future land use map shows what land will look like in the future, or what you want your community to look like in the future. It is not a zoning map, so sometimes those two get confused. As your community is contemplating zoning map changes, the Area Planning Commission right now would then look at the future land use map to see if that use that someone wants to rezone to is in line with what the community's vision is. So let's say that, you know, in this area where you're looking for residential to go, if there was an industrial proposal that they wanted to put in a salvage yard or, you know, smokestacks or something like that, you could say, no, that's not really our vision, but, you know, there might be an area of the city that is more appropriate for you, and according to our comp plan, you should maybe be, you know, where we have industrial outline. So it does help protect your property values. It helps you guys move forward in a way that is more intentional. And then tonight we are here for the adoption process. We did, like I said, do a public presentation of the plan last council meeting. In the meantime, we've gone to the Area Plan Commission where we did a public hearing. And now tonight we're here to have the commission, or not commission, the council make a recommendation on whether or not to adopt it.
All those in favor of adopting the comprehensive land use plan by passing resolution 2023-2, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
And congratulations, this is your community's first ever comprehensive plan, and that is such a huge step, and HLC has been really excited to be part of that process with you guys, so thanks for having us.
Thanks, Rachel.
Thanks, Rachel.
That isn't the first one.
Next, on the agenda is proposed ordinance 2023-1, enacting the code of ordinance. This is an annual recodification to include the items that were passed in the prior year. Is there a motion to pass ordinance 2023-1 on first reading?
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. I would entertain a motion to suspend the rules to pass ordinance 2023-1 on second and third readings on the night of introduction. Is there a motion?
I'd make that suspend the rules.
Is there a second? All in favor signify with aye.
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 So there being a unanimous vote, is there a motion to pass ordinance 2023-1 on second reading?
Second.
Is it Cody? Mm-hmm. All in favor signify with aye.
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 Is there a motion to pass ordinance 2023-1 on third and final reading?
Second.
All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Was presented, and a consensus from members of the council was to proceed with the ordinance to adopt that code of ethics. That proposed ordinance is presented as ordinance 2023-2, establishing a code of ethics. Is there a motion to pass ordinance 2023-2 on first reading?
Second.
Discussion? officers in 2023, one in January and one in July. And as the recruitment process is underway, we find that we are not as competitive as some other communities. And one of the areas in which we are not competitive, I think our salaries and benefits are certainly up there, but take-home cars has been an issue with some of the potential recruits. So Sergeant Geffert and Chief McCain are here tonight to present an overview of this issue and have a discussion about this. Thank you. Chief, you want to start us off?
Well, thank you, panel. Through the hiring process, it has been determined and has been learned that a lot of the departments, we're one of the few departments in the county other than the two county marshals departments that do not have a take-home car program. And it seems like that has hurt our level of applicants that have applied for the department. Not only do they want, good pay and benefits, this is another level of a benefit that they would like to have. And that's how come we drafted this, to see if we could entertain the idea of this so we could deepen our hiring pool. And at this point, we've had two people that have inquired about the department that were interested. And one of the first things they asked is, do we have a take-home car program? And the take-home car program would be where it is to and from work only. You have to live in Carroll County or one of the surrounding counties. And it's to get back and forth to work. Unless you live in Delphi, then you can have something limited off the transportation you go get. And it would also be to and from court, training, what else is there on there?
Work-related details.
If you were having to go, if you had a case that was going to be going to court, you had evidence up at the lab, and you could go get evidence, and you could schedule it on your own time and go as far as that. Right now we have four cars. We have a fifth one that is budgeted for this year, and for us to be fully equipped to have, we would need it. Additional, we're perfect for another two cars. That way we have seven vehicles for us at this point, and then down the road, possibly next year budget for two more cars. That way we would have enough for everybody take them car. One of the cars would be a cool car, and because we ran into this week, we have a car that's on a recall program. Or Ford, they had a transmission issue, so it's in Lafayette in service, and we had an electrical issue in another car, and then we had a check engine light come in to the third car. It was able to be reset. It seemed like it's operating properly, but really we were down to just one and a half cars. So this has always been for the smaller department, this has been an issue, but our big thing is this just gives us another level to entice people to come to Delphi and join the police department here because it's just a another benefit for us.
So what would be the eligibility requirements for this?
They would have to have, if they were a new officer, they would have to have completed their field training officer and be off probation. As far as that, then anybody else that would be available, it would be, you couldn't have a disciplinary write-up for 6 months. There's some other things. You have to make sure you're performing your job at an adequate level, and that to qualify for the take-home car program.
So
it would
be kind of a perk for,
yes.
Certainly for not just the new hires, but for existing officers and kind of the
officers that were thinking about maybe leaving it, and this, you know, this is the perk, you know, this is a pretty good option for us, and, yeah, it, you know, it's just another benefit.
So what we're doing is we're doing more and more departments are using this now, or using ones that are already.
I feel like every surrounding county, majority of departments are utilizing it, I think, the county only department is not, so I'm kind of partial as per the person, their administration, and the technical division have taken vehicles. But every other, let's all get it, sheriff's department, White County, Monticello.
Right, Clinton County, Flora, our sheriff's department, so the list that we're losing out on that pool of people that want that additional, that benefit. So that's why I think we have to take this for us, for hiring and retention policies.
So ideally, what's your total number of cars that are wanting, is it nine, or do you think 10 would be adequate? We get fully staffed this year to get the additional, the two officers that we have open for, but those at nine, and to have an additional car in case one of those would go down, or, you know, if an officer's sick and we need somebody that's either part-time to cover shifts to have a car available. So 10, and in the end, 10 would be the number that we could.
In a perfect world, 10 would be the number, as far as that, but there's nine of us, we can, if someone was sick, or someone had a car down, and we needed the car, and someone's on days off, we could realign that car temporarily until the car was repaired, as far as that. The guys might not like it, but it's one of those that's a benefit, and we, it's our car, and we can assign however, so that's kind of that.
And so the officers that we would hire this year would really not be eligible for a take-home car.
Correct, if they were new hire, or unless, you know, if they come from another agency, another law, another level, probationary status or not, but, yeah, that's more than likely that they have a law enforcement status, so we have to recruit the academy, the field training officers, probation, and by the time they go, that would be a year before that. So they would just have to have a car available to drive, and not necessarily for the physical purposes until operation.
So say you have the full staffing that you're looking for. What is the, is it like the goal for you guys is to have like two, you want day shift, two, you want a shift every day, is that kind of the?
That's ideally a complete person, that's where it'd be.
So, but just because I've heard a little about this, you could explain, on average, Carroll County, how many officers are on a given shift?
Well, for the sheriff's department, sometimes on a night shift, there could be one for the entire county. One officer for Delphi.
This is not like, I don't think, it's just, it's a little terrifying to me.
Yeah,
I feel like we need more
officers. And at times there can possibly be nobody on Flora, so we could have two officers in the whole county. That's not counting state police, and state police have, there are a lot of times they're up on the interstate, or they're, if they're assigned in this county, they might also be in a zone where they're also in White County. So, you know, it.
And on a great day, day shift usually when you have the sheriff, you know, you may have two for the sheriff's department, road deputies available, and two guys in the city. And occasionally four, they're kind of still, they're missing when they have somebody available, so. Best case scenario, you got six people, but worst case scenario, you have two for the entire county. So two officers on each rotation in Delphi would greatly improve safety for the citizen and for the police.
I have a question. If we have some officers that are out of county, is there any, I'm thinking about the additional gas. Would you have, I mean, would you just pay the gas for going in and out of the
If you live further than 25 miles, then you do not qualify for the program. If you live in surrounding, neighboring county, and you're 25 miles away, then you don't qualify for it. But if you do live within that, then yes, we would be paying, and there's an additional cost of that. But our cars right now are running. There's sometimes a guy gets out at 6 p.m. and another guy gets in at gets out, one guy gets in, and they're running 24 hours a day. You know, especially now when we're short, so you have that. But I know the initial cost is there, but over the long haul, you'll have less miles on the car, and you will, instead of getting rid of it maybe 3 years, you might have a retention of 7 or 8 years on that vehicle. Another thing we get in when you have a vehicle, if you switch a vehicle, say you have a 2019 and you're getting rid of it and you've got this equipment in it and you're getting a 2023, they've changed the configuration of the lights or the angles in the windshield. So a lot of the equipment, when we get rid of a vehicle, we'll get a box of equipment that we paid for that's basically obsolete, that we don't have any use for because they've changed the wiring harness. And once you start getting the wiring harness and they set them up, you can't use part of that. So you'd have that equipment in use longer.
Okay. Probably the answer to this, but it's great kind of perks and all that, but what benefits does the community have for where that person lives having the credits that police car? Does that make sense? Is it going to make a difference in safety and what's going on in the neighborhood?
When we're in the academy, they always teach the first line of defense is officer presence. They don't know that you're going home from work and this and that. To say if you live in the edge of Tiffin County or you're coming, you know, here to work and you're on the heartland and you're coming in to work, they don't know if you're, you know, what county, you know, or what you're doing, but they see a police car. And they think if they're up to no good, they're going to think, you know, I might want to go someplace else. So, and it gets, guys take pride in their vehicles, you know. And officers take pride in it. You know, as Jim Chisholm, they'll take better care of it, clean it more. They have it stocked and set up how they want it. There's just that pride of having your own.
And as well, you know, just, you know, my personal experience coming to and from work, times where, you know, people's driving behaviors on my way to work are pretty egregious. Mm-hmm. And, you know, given proper times, being able to, you know, if I was set up with a car, they could stop instead of trying to call ahead and hopefully somebody can get to it at some point. But, you know, those kinds of things. It's why I see people from Tiffin County or coming into Carroll County and Delphi. But on numerous occasions, I can count to occasions where people blow my doors off heading into work. So those little things kind of add up as well. Yeah.
So obviously, we didn't budget for this number of police cars for this year, and we haven't started budgeting for next year. So what is the minimum that you're asking? For council to consider at this point.
With us getting the fifth car this year.
Which is already budgeted.
Which is already, that's already counting.
And we have some money that we've encumbered for that vehicle that we'll have a little extra in it. So if we could get, in a perfect world, we could get two more cars and then the money to set that, you know, set up. And it's just not the car, it costs about for each vehicle to get set up. And I say set up, that's putting your equipment in it, your lights, your control panel for your lights, sirens, and all that. You're looking at about $10,000. And that's not in the mold we're ready to go in.
Yeah, so plus the cost of the radio.
Yeah, radio, you know, and radar.
What's it, 15? So, what, 42 for a vehicle and 15 for outfitting?
Yeah.
With radar and radio?
You could probably get one for 42 and then buy equipment and everything. I'd say another 20 would be on the high side. 10 for has a formal radio. Our radar is about $2,000. We put an AUV in all the cars. About $700. So it's just all those small things that then add up to it. But I think we're short selling ourselves if we don't look at this and all, because our hiring pool is just, there's people that say if you had a take-home car program, we would be good officers, and we're missing out. We need to be able to cast the widest net we can.
You're definitely part of that, hiring, but it's just like, besides that, just like capability. Surely two more cars is going to help, backup cars.
Yeah, especially just given this past week that we had with the manpower going.
Yes.
That obviously can't foresee everything, but this would be a good start. And hopefully, the longevity of vehicles will last a lot more, so there wouldn't be time to change a vehicle per year to swap one out.
So we're thinking about $60,000 per car. By the time the outfit with the radio equipment and the car.
$60,000.
And of course, we've already ran into this too, the sheriff's department was car values started going up. This year alone, they jumped over $10,000 just to get a basic floor. But that's, they used to be about $34,000, now they're over $42,000 or $43,000.
Yeah.
And that's how much you're going to get.
They're going up, they're not getting cheaper.
That's the same thing with the equipment too.
So, is this something that the council wants to entertain? How would you like to proceed? We certainly have a policy, a proposed policy, which Marion would love to look at, so get a copy of that for you. This is pretty much from our flexible, I believe, as I said, the recommendations for local. In order to make this work, obviously we can adopt a policy. Or give the police department the ability to adopt the policy. But without cars, we're probably not making it something that can be implemented. We budgeted for one car this year. I think the chief indicated we might have an extra 10 from another budget line item that could be moved over. But we're so early in the year that it's hard really to tell how much of that budget that was planned for last year. If we have additional maintenance on cars, as we already have tests, we could be cutting ourselves short. So,
how much money are you did you recover from last year?
Going to implement this policy and make a determination to purchase additional vehicles that would have to for additional appropriation. And I would bring it probably. And it's not something that we will do overnight, but it's a question of whether the council wants to proceed along that path. Obviously, with the man on vacation, this is something that we need to discuss with her as well. She'll be back next week. So, directionally, we could indicate how we would like to proceed, and then bring us back
fine. The problem is I just don't wanna have to do two and then like four police station. I know the cars cost that go up. That equipment's gonna go up just by the trends in the market for the last couple of years of ordered cars.
So when you're saying two cars this year,